It's been a while since I've talked in front of the camera like this. But 1,000 subscriber special, I kind of had to. No choice but to do it here. So, today I'm going to be doing a collection video. I've been meaning to do this for years. Actually, years. I actually filmed this back in 2018, and I'm going to post some of the clips that I filmed from when I did it back then in this video too, so you can see what my collection was like then, see what I had to say about, my match balls and all that stuff back in 2018. I actually haven't edited the video yet, so I don't even know what I said. Hopefully it's not too cringy, but we'll find out. We'll see. So before this video starts, I want to thank a few people first. So before I thank specific people, let me just thank everyone in general. 1,000 subscribers is a huge deal to me. It genuinely means more than you know, especially on YouTube. I hit 1,000 Instagram followers, I think it was last year. So that was a big deal, but hitting it on YouTube, the platform that I started on and continue to love posting on the most, really means a lot. So thank you to everyone that subscribed, the original subscribers, the new ones. I really appreciate it. So yeah, first person I want to thank is obviously my dad. Literally, I think he's commented on every video I've ever posted. There was even one that I had to delete because of some copyright thing. I think he commented on that. So yeah, and he probably commented on some videos from my old channel, which was Just Kick It. If any of you remember that, you guys get bonus points. That's insane. When I started to make this channel, I made Just Kick It with my mom's email. And so the first video I actually posted was the second video that's on Just Knuckle It now. So I ended up deleting that YouTube channel because I realized I needed my own email for things. And yeah, along with that, I decided to change the name too. But regardless, shout out my dad. He probably commented on that channel. He's been commenting for the entirety of my time on YouTube and supporting me. So it means a whole lot. So thank you. Next person I want to shout out is Ben Rowe. I mean, again, one of the originals who was commenting on my videos. And outside of commenting on my videos, he's helped me out a lot on Instagram in particular. And he's also just shown so much support throughout the years. And he's also just a really nice guy. So make sure you follow him by Ben Rowe. That's kind of his new project, photography on that. And he's really good at it. So check him out. I'll make sure to link that in the description. Also, Ben is filthy at knuckleball free kicks. I know he's moved on to photography now, which is great. But yeah, make sure you check out some of his older free kicks too, because he is disgusting. Hits some really, really nice shots. Next person I want to shout out is Freekick Lad, or David. He's been just showing support on the channel again for years now, literally years. And outside of showing support, he has inspired me tremendously, free kick wise. I think he is one of the best free kick takers there is, period. If you haven't seen his free kicks, I highly recommend checking out his channel. I mean, seriously, some of the craziest movements I've ever seen. And every time he posts a video and I see it, I want to go out and take free kicks myself. So yeah, shout out David, shout out Freekick Lad. I'll link it in the description. So yeah. And the next group of people, I guess I should say, that I want to shout out are the Knuckleball Twins. So yeah, they've been an inspiration of mine for years, since before I started my YouTube channel. I think there were a few people that were really big influences on me, Buddhism, Lucas football, free kickers, but Knuckleball Twins were right up there with those guys. And yeah, along with showing support on my channel, they continue to post quality videos and have been posting them for 10 plus years at this point. I know this year they recently reached that 10-year anniversary mark, which is really cool. But yeah, they post great videos. Again, Sammy is one of the best free kick takers there is, period. Like, consistency wise, highlights wise, he's been shooting from 40 yards, which I still can't do. I go out to shoot sometimes and I try shooting from like 30, 40 yards out, and it's just horrendous, and I end up just moving closer. But anyways, shout out Knuckleball Twins. Great channel, and I appreciate their support. Another person I want to shout out is Nico Mankila. I hope I'm saying that right. Again, great guy. He's been supporting the channel for years now. And again, another great free kick taker. I'm going to link his channel in the description too. Got a great technique and really good edits too. Quality edits. Some of those slow motion free kick videos are great. I love those. And yeah. Shout out Nico Mankila. I appreciate the support. Person I want to shout out is Noah Dommaschk. Again, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing that wrong. But he has been showing support for the channel, just like everyone else, for years now. And that long-time support just means a lot. I mean, that's honestly one of my biggest inspirations to keep posting free kick videos. I mean, I love to do it for myself, but like, obviously hearing from certain people is nice too, especially when you're hearing it from people that are also really passionate about taking free kicks and that are good at it themselves, like Noah Dommaschk. Once again, check out his YouTube channel. He has hit some crazy knuckleballs, and outside of that has some pretty funny videos too. I know me and my friend Embry, we used to take free kicks together all the time. We used to just get a kick out of this video where he's like kicking in the rain and he's wearing these like baggy sweatpants and they're like, it looks like he pissed himself, but like he didn't really. I don't know. It was just a funny video at the time, and he's got some other stuff on his channel that's great too. So definitely check him out, and I appreciate the support over the years. I really do. And lastly, I want to shout out Old Number 9. Again, showing support for years now. And again, one of the most underrated free kick channels that there is, period. I mean, he is, along with Freekick Lad, I think, and Knuckleball Twins, I think up there with the best free kick takers on YouTube. Amazing technique, shoots from really far out, incredible highlights. I'm gonna link him down below, so definitely check out his channel. I highly recommend it. So yeah, that's about it for the people that I wanted to shout out. Obviously there are more who have been showing support recently, but I think those are the people that I really wanted to highlight in this video. But of course, thank you to everyone who has subscribed over the years. This is a huge milestone for me. I don't plan on stopping. I still love what I do. I wouldn't be posting if I didn't. But yeah, that's pretty much all I wanted to say. So let's get into the collection video. I'm going to be kind of talking a little bit about each ball and the cleats that I have briefly. I'll try and keep it brief because this is going to be a long video. But enough talking. Let's get into it.
I'd like to introduce my main man, Zakari. Take it away, man.
I'm still at Alicorn. Chrome hearts on like gold. Chrome 24s jumping like Johnny. But in the night, I still slide the suburban.
Alright, so the first ball I want to talk about is the Europa League Jabulani, or the ball for the 2010 through 11 Europa League tournament. So this is a special ball, maybe my favorite match ball of all time, I'm not sure. It moves a ton. Obviously it's a Jabulani, so they pretty much all do, but this one in comparison to the other ones that I've had in the past, it feels a little bit more robust and solid. It's a little bit hard to explain, but it just feels a little bit easier to keep it under the bar. It doesn't feel as floaty as the other Jabulani's that I've used have, but it still has that just insane movement. And not to mention, I think it's one of the best looking balls ever made. I love Powerorange match balls, and I think this one in particular, with like the simplistic design on the front with that like Europa League logo, the Adidas logo, it just looks amazing. In the air, in hand, it's great. Definitely one of my favorites. Next ball we got is a more recent one. It's the Uniforia for the Euro 2020 tournament. Yeah, I got this one not too long ago, and it's a Telstar variant, but kind of similar to the Europa League Jabulani. I feel like this one is just more robust. It's literally the exact same as the Europa League ball in the sense that it's not as floaty. It's easier to keep under the bar when compared to the normal Telstar, at least in my opinion. But yeah, it's a really nice ball. I like the feel of this one a lot. It's pretty hefty compared to the lighter Adidas match balls like the Jabulani and Teamgeist. Good grip, good for freestyle. It's got good sweet spots. You can see the panels are fairly large. And looks wise, it's incredible. I mean, like, as soon as I saw it, I was like, I gotta get this. The silver design with those white accents, I'm not entirely sure what they detail, but it looks great. And yeah, the different colors, I think it says like different cities on it too, like London, and I think maybe another one where they had a game. But yeah, it's just a really cool match ball. I wouldn't say it's one of my favorites, but it's definitely a really cool ball. Now this next one is definitely one of my favorites. One of my first match balls ever. It's the Europa League 2009-10 match ball. This one still has the Europass design to it, which is nice because I think it's one of the best designs for a match ball, at least that I've ever used. It's just got a really nice feel to it when taking free kicks, playing with it, freestyling in particular. It's got good grip, unlike the Teamgeist. Yeah, performance-wise, it's great, I think. And on top of that, looks-wise, I just think this ball is amazing. I love the burgundy colors of it, just like on all the other Europa League balls. The yellow accents, and the ball is kind of this, like, off-white color. It stands out. It's almost more silver-like than anything. And yeah, it's just a really cool design, performs really well, definitely one of my favorites, and I feel like not too many people have this one either, so yeah. Here we got another Europass style ball, again, a very special ball here. This was for the African Cup of Nations in 2008, it's called the Wawa Aba. Really unique design. I mean, all of the African Cup of Nations balls look really unique. They have the yellow palette with the green and the red. It looks amazing. I mean, I remember when I got this ball for the first time, I think it was probably the most shocked I ever was, because like, it looks that much better in real life. And in the air too, it's just so unmistakable. It's just really a great design. And just like the Europa League ball, it performs great as well. It's amazing for knuckleballs, great for freestyle, and just generally pretty good to use overall. I mean, it's not the most reliable. It does move a lot, but still, I like using it. Next up is the most iconic match ball of all time, undeniably. I cannot believe how many people still talk about this ball to this day. And I mean, I can't say that there isn't good reason for that. It is iconic, it does look incredible, and it does perform different from just about any other match ball you're gonna use. You know, everyone says that this is the best ball for knuckleballs, and I can tell you, as someone who's used it, that's true, at least as far as match balls go. But yeah, the ball comes in a really cool box. I like that they show all those World Cup match balls there. But yeah, this was for the 2010 South Africa World Cup. Caused a lot of controversy. The one I have as actually, it has the JFA logo, which I think is the Japanese Football Association. So maybe that adds a little bit of rarity. It's got a little bit of, it's got a few differences on it, like on the valve and that. But yeah, this ball, it's a lot of fun to take free kicks with. I actually think it's fun to play with too. I have played with it before, not with this one in particular. This one's new, I'm not gonna use it, but with the Powerorange version, I have played with it before. And it's a little bit unreliable, sure, but it's a fun ball to play with. I think it has a really nice touch, actually, if you inflate it. It can be floaty, but still, good for freestyle, great for knuckleballs, of course, and iconic design. Love it. So here we have the Nike Ascente, one of two Nike match balls that I have. And this one is a new match ball. I've had it for a while. I don't ever plan on using it. But yeah, it's got a really cool design to it. I've actually used the Nike Ascente before, not this exact one, but my friend Embry had one. And it's a really nice ball. It's got a firm feel to it, but I think it's more pingy than the modern Nike balls are, which I like a little bit more. And I know some people think this ball moves a lot. I personally haven't had a lot of luck with it, knuckle-wise, but still, that doesn't detract from the ball. It's a really nice ball to kick, really nice to play with too. And like I said, I think the design is really interesting. I like those gray accents with the white panels, and the blue on the Premier League version looks great. And yeah, it's a really solid ball. On to the next Nike ball in my collection, and this one being the Nike Flight ball. So off the rip, I just want to say the design is fantastic. I think it looks amazing. It's like a comic book style design. Like, the graphics really do pop in real life, and it just looks, it looks awesome. Yeah, this ball also has really big sweet spots, which I like. It's, I don't know how many panels it is. I think it's just three panels, but they're really big. And they have the ball has this like really intense grooving on it, which provides a whole lot of grip. It's immediately noticeable if you juggle the ball, or if you're dribbling it. But yeah, the way I would describe this ball is it's a little bit of a brick. It's way more heavy than any Adidas ball I've ever used. And on top of that, it's very difficult to kick. It's, I know Nike claimed that the ball moves like, I don't know what they said, 30% less than any other ball they've ever made or something like that. And I have to say that's probably true. It does not knuckle easily at all. And aside from knuckling the ball, it's just difficult to get a good shot with it in general. I feel like you really have to hit it perfectly to get a lot of velocity behind it. Which is kind of a good and bad thing, in the sense that it's very rewarding. When you hit a good shot with it, it's like the most satisfying thing ever. So yeah, it's an interesting ball for sure. I think I like the way it looks more than I like the way it performs, but either way, it's a cool ball. Next up, we got the 2022 World Cup match ball, the Al Rihla. So this one, my dad got this ball. He actually managed to get it for a really good price at Dick's Sporting Goods. Yeah, I just don't think the people knew what they were selling there. That's all I'll say. Anyways, the ball, it looks amazing. I have to say, like, I remember when I saw the ball, it got leaked on Instagram, like a while before they officially announced the ball. And I didn't love it. I was kind of disappointed. But in real life, this ball looks fantastic. It's got this pearlescent finish to it, and that combined with the vibrant blues, yellows, oranges, it's just a really cool looking ball. And I haven't used it yet. I'm planning on getting the finals version whenever that comes out. So yeah, I'll tell you what I think about the performance when I get my hands on the finals ball. But for now, what I can say is it looks amazing, and it's the ball for one of the most iconic World Cups of all time. I think if you took a poll amongst the Freekick YouTubers about which match ball was their favorite, sure, the Jabulani would be up there, but I think that the Red Team just could possibly be number one. I feel like this is everybody's favorite ball, and you know, it's for good reason. Looks-wise, this is easily one of the best match balls ever made. The hourglass-shaped panels, the black outline, the old FIFA-approved logo, the smooth finish to it, it's just something special. And in hand and in air, it's easily one of the best-looking match balls, no doubt about it. And also on top of that, I think it's one of the best-performing match balls as well. Sure, it's unpredictable, no doubt about it. I think that aside from the Jabulani, this is probably the craziest moving match ball there is, but it's really pingy. It's got a really nice feel to it. I know the Europass, those type of balls are similar, but I don't feel like they perform quite as well as the team just does. I've even had friends who have kicked this ball who picked up on how nice it feels. This is the one that people always say they like to kick. And yeah, I can certainly understand why. It's just a great ball for everything. Playing, freestyle, free kicks. If you can get one for a decent enough price, I recommend it. And just like the Red Team, just if you find one of these for a decent enough price, you should absolutely buy it. I think the 2006 Team Gist for the Germany World Cup is one of the best balls ever made. It might be my favorite. I know I said that about the orange Europa League ball, but this is up there too. I think I like this a little more than the Red Team Gist. I just prefer the black and gold outline. But yeah, all the things I said about the Red Team just basically apply to this one too. It performs fantastically. It looks amazing. I think the only critique that I have with the team just is the thermal bonding could be better. It doesn't seem to, the panels don't seem to hold together as well as the modern match balls, but what can you really expect? And also the surface being smooth makes it so that when it's wet, it's a little bit slippery. It's kind of hard to control, but aside from that, this is a near perfect ball. Easily one of my favorites. From 2006 to 2014, we have the Adidas Brazuca, the World Cup ball for Brazil. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's because this was the first match ball I owned, and it was also the first World Cup I watched. Maybe that's why this design is just so iconic to me. But when I think of like a World Cup ball, just something about this design in particular, I feel like represents Brazil so well. Yeah, it's just easily recognizable from distance, and in your hands, it looks amazing. I think a lot of what makes the Al Rihla so good for this year's World Cup kind of applies to the Brazuca as well. It's got great colors. I like how the design follows the panels too. I think that's a nice touch. And yeah, looks aside, this is a really solid ball. I think it's comparable to the Telstar, although I like it a little bit less because I find that this ball is somewhat floaty, kind of like the Jabulani was. So because of that, it's a little bit hard to control. But with that being said, if you hit it right, it absolutely knuckles a lot, and it curves a lot as well, and it's a very pingy ball too. So it's fun to play with, but it's not my favorite ball overall. Don't ask me how to pronounce this ball. The Comoequa? That's my best guess. I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, because I probably am. But anyways, this is the ball for the African Cup of Nations tournament. I'm not entirely sure what year this was. It was probably like 2012 or 2013. But this is the only ball that I have with the Tango 12 design. And it's not my favorite performance-wise. I think it's kind of like in between the Jabulani and Brazuca. It's more stable than the Jabulani, but it doesn't quite have that like pingy feel that the Brazuca has. So it's just kind of in that middle ground, which is why it's not the most exciting ball for me. However, looks-wise, I think it's a great-looking ball. I love the yellow. The colors are great, similar to the Wawa Aba. The reasons why I love how that looks kind of apply to this ball as well. But yeah, I wouldn't say it's one of my favorites, but it's nice. Alright, another Dick's Sporting Goods special here. Managed to get this one. It was in a rack with a bunch of other like balls from different sports, and it was just kind of in there a little bit dirty, and we just brought it up to the register, and the guy literally gave it to us for $20. So yeah, this was the best deal I've ever gotten to Matchball, so that's got to count for something. But yeah, I'm not sure what year this Champions League ball was for, maybe 2015. It's the only Champions League ball I have at this moment. I don't use it, but I have used the Champions League balls in the past, and for the most part, I think they're pretty decent. Free kick-wise, they're some of my least favorite match balls. I think they're really floaty. It's easy to get a lot of curve on them, and it's also very easy to just blow these over the crossbar. However, I think these balls are some of the best for freestyle because they're light, because they're soft, and because they have a lot of grip as well. They make for really good freestyle balls, but yeah, wouldn't say it's one of my favorites. That being said, here we have one of my favorite match balls of all time. I don't think there are many balls that have ever been made that look better brand new than this one. I mean, I just don't think I could ever take this onto the turf and use it. It's just too beautiful. I mean, it's literally glistening. I guess the other Jabulani is the same way, but this one I just think looks better than the Jabulani. The gold accents that kind of sparkle out from the center of those panels, and the gold guitar pick panels themselves look phenomenal on the white finish with the black outline. And I like how it doesn't have those markings that are on the outside of those guitar pick panels. I think the Jabulani design looks cleaner without those. But yeah, I have used the Jo'bulani before, and it is a really nice ball. It performs, you know, just like the other Jabulani's would. But it's just a great ball. It really is. Here we have the 2018 Telstar. This was for the World Cup in Russia in 2018. And this is probably, at least design-wise, the most underwhelming World Cup match ball. I don't think it looks bad by any means. It just is certainly not a standout like the Jabulani, Teamgeist, Brazuca, or even the Al Rihla, I'd say. But yeah, like I said, I think it's a decent-looking ball. And I think it's a really nice performing ball, too. Like, if I had to choose one match ball to play with in an actual game, it would probably be the Telstar. I think it's a good combination of like the Brazuca and some of the newer Nike match balls. It's a little bit heavier than the Brazuca was. It's a little bit firmer, I'd say, but it still has that nice ping to it. And I think it's capable of moving quite a bit as well, which is nice. So yeah, and I think it's good for freestyle as well. The chip that's inside of it is absolutely useless. I don't really think I need to go over that. Yeah, got the red valve. It's a good ball, really nice performing. Not my favorite looks wise though. With that being said, the knockout stage ball for the 2018 World Cup, I think, looks much, much better. The red graphics that replace the kind of silver graphics that were on the original Telstar look way, way better, in my opinion. I've never used this particular match ball. This one I'm going to keep for the collection, but Embry, my friend Embry, he had one of these, and it looks so good when flying through the air. The red is just amazing. Yeah, the only thing that I'm kind of like disappointed about is that they didn't make a finals ball for the 2018 World Cup. I think they should always make a ball with some gold on it, and I think they kind of learned their lesson, because with the Al Rihla, they made the Al Hilm, which has a gold base to it, which I think is amazing. But nonetheless, this is a really cool ball. A little bit more rare and elusive than the normal Telstar was, which is also cool. But, you know, same thing as the Telstar. Performs really well. Great for freestyle. Great for actually playing. And pretty good for free kicks, too. I think it's a ball worth getting, you know? Back to 2014, we have the Brazuca Final Rio Match Ball. So, similar to other final balls, I think this one looks better than the original Match Ball. Maybe not as easily recognizable as the actual Brazuca, but just something about the green and gold looks fantastic. Again, I think this ball represents Brazil so well. And I just wish there were more match balls that used this green and gold color combination. It really looks amazing. But yeah, what I said about the original Brazuca applies to this one as well. I think one thing worth noting about the Brazuca as well as the Telstars is the durability is fantastic. I've had the Brazuca for 7 years now, and it performs just as well as it did as when I got it. The only thing about these match balls is the paint does not stay intact very well. It tends to kind of like splatter all over the ball. I know with this one in particular, it probably just kind of go all over the white. So if you care about preserving the looks, maybe not the best ball to get, but you know, for collectors especially, this is a really cool ball to have. Lastly, we got another one of my favorites here. The Adidas Europass, the Powerorange version. Yeah, this ball, it looks so nice. I love the normal Europass design. It kind of like resembles that, you know, default stock image soccer ball look. But it just looks a little bit better than that. It's more modernized, you know. It's just a classy design in my opinion. And something that I love about this ball is the sweet spots on it are really nice. Whenever I'm taking free kicks with the Europass, I set the ball up so that those big kind of like navy blue circles face me, and I feel like it always helps me hit the ball in the right spot. And for that reason, I just love taking free kicks with it. Literally for that reason alone. Obviously, it performs great. It knuckles a ton. I think I probably hit my best free kick of the year with this ball. And for that reason alone, you know, it'll always be one of my favorites. So now I just wanted to go over some of my cleats. These are the Nike Mercurial Proximos. I think that's the name of them. I could be wrong. It's been a while since I got these, and it's been a while since I've actually worn them. I really wanted these mainly because I tried on the Superfly 4s and enjoyed that cleat a lot, and I already had cleats at the time, so I wanted to get something for futsal. I wish I got these in the indoor variation so I could actually freestyle in them a little bit more. But either way, I think these are actually pretty nice shoes. I'd still love the fit of the Superfly 4. I like the collar. It keeps out turf pellets pretty well. It's got this cool look to it. When you stretch the material, it kind of has this, you can see the material that's underneath the base material, which is cool. I always thought this colorway was amazing as well. And yeah, I think they're pretty nice shoes. I can't say that I'd like strongly recommend them, but they're pretty cool. Now we have the Vapor 13s. I got these last year, and they're good and bad. I have some complaints about them, and I have some positive things I'd say about them. Looks-wise, this colorway is fantastic. I absolutely love the red and silver. It looks great. The sole plate and stud pattern, it's very similar to the past. I don't even know how many Mercurials, aside from the one, the most recent one, they've been using the stud pattern for maybe like the past four or so. But the upper has a really nice feel to it. It's kind of sock-like. It fits really tight, which usually I like, but these actually kind of gave me foot cramps when playing. When kicking, they're fine. So for that reason, they're not my favorite cleats, but either way, they look great, and the feel for the ball is really nice. The last piece of my collection is the cleats that I've been wearing for the past 6 months or so, the Nike Tiempo Legend 9s. These, I would probably say, are the nicest cleats I've ever had. Fit-wise, they are so comfortable. I went through so many cleats to try and find the right ones for my soccer season. And when I put these on, it was just like, yeah, these are the ones. They're just so comfortable, every part about them. And they're leather too, so they stretch out. If you have wide feet, it's just gonna fit you even better than a synthetic cleat would. Also, the stud pattern is really nice. I prefer the circular studs because if you play on turf and you have the chevron studs, it's a little bit harder to pivot, I find. So that's another bonus about these cleats. And even after using them a whole lot, kicking and playing, the durability has been really good. Considering how light they are and the fact that they're leather, I think that's quite impressive. So I highly, highly recommend at least trying on the Nike Tiempo Legend 9.
This ball is definitely gonna be my second favorite on the list. This is one of my more recent match balls, and I'll find it for you. It is the Europass Powerorange. So this ball is from 2008, and again, this thing knuckles like crazy. Another reason I really like it is because I think it looks maybe the best when spinning in the air, because of those dots and the orange. It just mixes really well together. And again, can't really find anything bad to say about this ball, and it's gonna have to be my second favorite looks wise and performance wise. The next ball that I have is Nike Ordem. So this was used for the 2015 through 16 season, I'm pretty sure. Check. Well, all right, well, doesn't say. But I'm pretty sure that's what it was. Oh, there you go, 15 through 16. And it's a really good ball. I did a test and review if you wanna go and check it out. It is very, very good for curves. If you wanna take some curving free kicks, then this is the ball that I would recommend buying. It doesn't go for that much. I'm sure on eBay you could find it for like, probably under $80. And it's a good performing ball, especially for game situations. It's really good. It's very reliable. It's not gonna be like the others and knuckle a lot, but it's good for curves. Not my favorite though, cause obviously it doesn't knuckle a lot. Next ball in my match ball collection is the Adidas Jabulani. So just like the Power Orange one, it knuckles like heck. Goalkeeper nightmare, 2010 World Cup ball. They retail for $160, but now the only place you can find them is eBay, because they don't make them anymore because it's from 2010. And they are extremely expensive, so if you can find one for a decent price, I would say it is worth it because it really is crazy how much the ball moves. It's just great. So yeah, always gonna like it. And my first ball with the Jabulani design. So starting off with the Brazuca, my first match ball I ever got. And this is just, I really, really like this ball. The durability is just incredible. Also, knuckles a lot. Also really, really good for curves and probably one of the best performing balls in game. So really, really like this one. And of course, it's my first ball. So all right, next up we have one of my favorites on the list, the Europa League ball. So this was from the 2009-10 season. And yeah, this has the same design as the Europass. And if you know your match balls, you know that a Europass knuckles like heck. So no different with this one. I've almost scored some of my best goals with it. And I just think it looks really cool as well. Take it out. But yeah, I just really like the way this one looks, especially in the air. When my dad's goalie, he says he hates being goalie for this one, so even better for me. But yeah, this is always going to be one of my favorites. I really wanted this ball, and getting it was just great. So, one of my favorites. So this ball is called the Nike Insight. So this is just the standard one. There's no specific league, but it has the same design as the Nike Ascente, which is one of the few Nike balls that actually knuckles a lot. And I actually managed to find this one, lucky for me. And it does actually knuckle quite a bit. So if you want something different than Adidas, this is a great ball to have. And they go for extremely cheap. Just search Nike Insight or Nike Ascente, depending on which one you want. I really like the ball. It's pretty much good for everything besides freestyle because it actually seems bigger than most match balls. It just, for some reason, I don't know why. But yeah, I like it for everything. So great ball. And I think you've all heard of it before, the Adidas Jabulani, but in Powerorange. So quick little look at the box there. Take it out. If I can even get it out. There we go. So if you know your match balls again, you would know that this one knuckles probably the most. Whenever you kick it, even if you don't have the technique, it just flies all over the place. I don't really know how this one got approved to be an actual match ball, but it did, and I'm happy about it. So probably the most fun ball to shoot, and also I think my favorite looking ball. I just think the Powerorange on the Jabulani design looks just better than anything, really. So definitely my favorite, and I don't actually know if I'm ever going to get a ball that I like more than this one, so I'm going to say my favorite match ball of all time. All right, the final and my newest match ball that I have is the Red Teamgeist. So it's basically the exact same as a normal Teamgeist, except this panel portion thing is red and black, which I personally think looks better than the normal Teamgeist. This is one of my favorite looking match balls. But yeah, it's just good for everything. Free kicks, it's insane. And freestyle, it's actually maybe even better for freestyle. Really like this one. See a lot of professional freestylers using it as well. Maybe not this version, maybe the normal Teamgeist, because this one goes for just a ton on eBay, and they're also extremely rare. All right, so the first boot in my collection is the Mercurial Finale. So this is the first generation. It's a pretty old shoe. As you can see, I've used it quite a bit. But they are extremely good. Pretty much every single category they're good in. They remind me a lot of the Hypervenom 1, if you remember that boot. So it's a really, really good shoe to buy. It's very cheap as well, so just a great all-around shoe. So really like that one. The next shoe I have is the Nike Mercurial Veloce. So this is the low-end model to the Vapor. Basically, the only difference is it doesn't have the one-piece upper, so as you can see, it does have a tongue. But pretty much everything is the same. They're just a really, really good shoe overall. They perform really good. It has a nice barefoot feel. And just can't really say anything too bad about it, except for the durability. So that could be a little bit better, but overall, great shoe. The next boot I have on my list is the X15.1. So this was the first line to the X. This is actually the first colorway too. And it got a lot of criticism because of the color, which I personally like, which is why I got this one. And yeah, it's just a really good performing shoe. I did a test on it with Embry, but that was a really long time ago. It's a really bad video. You can check it out, but I wouldn't recommend it. But anyways, just a great shoe. There's absolutely nothing wrong with this. The comfort is perfect. The touch is really good, and the durability is great as well. So you can pick them up for probably under $100 at the moment, and they're just a really good shoe to buy. The next shoe that I have is the Mercurial X Proximo, the second one, sorry. And as you can see, it has the same design as the Superfly 5 with the collar right here and the design. Obviously no sole plate because it is an indoor model, but this is a lot better than the first generation. I did a test and review on the first one, if you want to go and check that out. But basically what's better is the heel. There's no blisters anymore, pressure marks. Maybe a little bit at the beginning, but it's nowhere near as bad as the old one. So I'm really happy that Nike fixed that. And also there's a lot more underfoot cushioning on this one. So it's a really, really good shoe. I'd probably wait until the next one came out to get a further discount on it, because they can be a little bit pricey at the moment, but a good boot to buy. All right, the next boot on the list, or not really a boot, it's an indoor shoe, is the Adidas X16.1 Court. So this is pretty much good in every category again. The upper's really soft and comfortable against your foot, and it's also a lot lighter than the Proximo is, which is the reason I think I prefer it to the Proximo. It's really good for freestyle, has a nice touch, and I just can't really find anything bad to say about it, so yeah. So the next boot on the list, and this one actually is a boot, is the Mercurial Vapor 11. So this is a shoe that I've wanted for a really long time. I wanted to get the Vapor 10 originally, but never managed to get it. So when I got this, it was so cool, because I think the design just looks absolutely amazing. This is one of my favorite Nike colorways. And also, this is probably the best performing shoe that I've ever worn. They're extremely, like when you get them, you just can't believe how light they are. And the upper is somehow really soft considering how light they are. So it's just amazing how they did that. And yeah, again, can't really say anything bad about this. I've heard the durability can get a little bit so-so, but I haven't seen that yet. So until then, perfect, perfect boot. Okay, so finally we have the Ace 17.1 Pure Control in the indoor version. I think it's called the Tango something. I don't know the exact name actually. But might not be the best performer like the Vapor 11, but I have to admit it, these are my favorites. The comfort is so good on these. The fit could be better, especially when you're making side-to-side movements if you have smaller feet, but I just really like the comfort, and the touch is so good. It almost feels like leather. I would almost go that far, but it's just really nice. I can't say anything bad, really. They do go for quite a bit of money at the moment. You're not going to really find any discounts, but if you do, I would encourage you to go and pick these up, because they are so awesome, and especially the Red Limit one because of how cool they look in real life. So definitely going to be my favorite boots at the moment. All right, that's going to be it for my collection video. The next one, again, is going to be in about a year, so hopefully the collection gets even better. But if you want to know my favorite boots, the Ace 17.1 Pure Controls, and my favorite football is Powerorange Jabulani. So that's my picks. Let me know yours in the comments below, favorite boots and ball, and also let me know why. But again, that's going to be it. So I'll see you next time.